Now, see here. I wear the big hat now, and I decide what goes down in this archive. And what's going down today is French Bread's Dark Souls 3 Lorerun. I am, of course, French Bread, or Chris, sometimes. And, we are back in the Grand Archives. Taking the wrong shortcut. Fortunately, where we left off last time in the series could have been better, but we found ourselves positively tapped out of Estus after the Corvian debacle, we'll call it. So we'll just have to make our way back to where we were before. As you are no doubt noticing, I have changed up the fashion once again. Ooh, just made it. Today we are wielding a +5 Eleonora, a Shield of Want, Sage's Big Hat, Morn's Armor, and the Drang Gauntlets and Shoes. The hat is actually a bit of a temporary fixture. I think it looks alright. Gotta love the old Plague Doctor mask thing. But we're actually going to be looking to replace it with some headgear we're going to get, I do believe, later on in this episode. So, yeah, we're pretty close to being back to where we were. I'm already sad that I've taken off my spell parry shield. It was way cooler than this cruddy old Shield of Want. But what can you do? That spell parry shield just did not go with our shoes. Not worth it. Not worth it. Not worth it. Probably not worth it. Let's see if it was worth it. I didn't even get a chance to see what kind of ring that was, except that I'm pretty sure it was a bite ring. Yes. Flesh bite ring. Exact same description as all the other bite rings. Except this one raises poison, bleed, frost, and curse resist. It's the king of bite rings, I guess. We'll never wear it. As you can see, we have no choice but to loop back around. But this time, we don't need to go down to where the Corvians are. Oh, shoo. Almost rolled right on down. Ah. We are also, given the fact that the Eleonora... I don't think that's my problem anymore. Given that the Eleonora does not... is not buffable, I was thinking maybe we would try... Okay, I know there's a gargoyle just took off. Is this part of some conspiracy to kill me by a power within? I don't know what happened there. Normally he would just land on the roof and then we'd have a tussle, but well, I guess. Let's just proceed normally and maybe we'll actually fight the next gargoyle we run into. I can tell he's kinda up there and there's one there. We're gonna try a sixth strat of activating the feast bell, activating power within, and then doing what we can do. Please come. Please fucking a little quicker. See, I don't need you over there. And power within is... oh! Are we not gonna fight a single gargoyle in this episode? let me enjoy my sick combo. Please. Please, all I want to do... Ow, is fight you. Looks like the healing on the Eleonora is not... you know, it's not amazing. It's not great game-breaking, but it does seem to at least partially offset the damage of power within. Which makes it sort of a shame that both buffs seem to have so short a duration that I don't know if it's worth it. That's a huge bummer. Maybe we'll, I don't know, learn a sorcery or something. We did become the holders of the legacy of the Crystal Sages, i.e. Logan and Seath. I don't know. We'll see. Blech. This is what I get for trying new things. If you run off the ledge here, you can see that we were able to get to the upper balcony from the place with the multitude of cursed books. And we are rewarded with an undead bone shard to boot. And an ember, I guess, if you're into that sort of thing. Pick a ladder. Unlock a, I don't know, maybe a decent shortcut. And here, can definitely see what looks like it's going to be the way forward, but we're gonna head over here first. Ah, really gotta respect the damage these guys do. And speaking of respecting damage, oh, I don't like that at all. Somehow we managed to score. A backstab out of that improbable maneuver. Wow, these Scholar Lothric Knights just don't pack the same punch that the Priestess supported ones do. Or maybe we're stronger. One of those. This section right here is where we confronted the two Crystal Lizards before in the last episode, and where both of our gargoyles just kinda, I don't know, fell off ledges and left us be. You could walk down off of there in order to reach this upper area in the library. Archive. It's an archive. For however much difference it makes. And up here, we got what looks to be some kind of brass cage and a man grub. We'll get to that probably in this episode. We've got bigger problems before we do. It's just like summoning in as a red phantom. Prince Lothric, or I don't know, someone has prepared a gank party for our entertainment. At the top, we've got Daughter of Crystal, Krimhild, the invading phantom we fought in the Untended Graves. We've got what I believe to be our old friend, Lion Knight Albert, in his, I suppose, his true role as a defender of Prince Lothric. And we've got what looks to be another one of the King's Black Hands. Not Gotthard, because we found him dead, and this one is actually wielding katanas, so we'll see once we, hopefully, fingers crossed, strip the items from his corpse. Just who he might be. Now, you can aggro one of them to begin with, but after a very short period of time, they're all going to get on your case. So do what work you can while you can. Ooh, lucky. And that is enough to take out old Lionel. Golden Crest Shield. What kind of shield is that? Spell Parry. Ah, the timing is tighter. Whoa! This interesting homing soul mass. I guess it's a little slower, understandably, than the small shield variety. Ah, yeah, there we go. We did some. Should probably stop screwing around, though, for these guys. Properly. Ooh, do something like that to us. You wouldn't hit the lady while she's chugging, would you? Nice homing, nice homing. Ooh. Good idea, my friend. I'm awful at this spell parry thing. And down goes that one. Large arrows. Okay, fine. Maybe I should have waited until we won. Let's get one more delicious chug in before we ruin this lady's day for the second time. You know, she doesn't have a crystal rapier this time. That was a mistake. Sage's Crystal Staff. There we go. Let's check out all these items we just pillaged before we move any farther forward. Onikiri and Ubadaitachi. The hunters known as the King's Black Hands wielded paired weapons. These belonged to Kamui, who looked after the prince. Kamui brought Onikiri with him to the undead settlement, where he forged Ubadachi, and was finally prepared to join the ranks of the Royal Hunters. And its weapon skill is Oni Slayer. I think we saw him use it once. It's that jumping attack where he slices both swords out. Somehow defies gravity for a fraction of a second. Pretty cool ability. We also received the Sage's Crystal Staff. Crystal catalysts presented as a gift by the Crystal Sages to their favorite pupil, Krimheld. Crystal spheres devour the will of the user, and this staff increases the potency of sorceries at the cost of increased FP consumption for skills. So this actually functions in a very similar manner to the, what was it, the tin crystallization catalyst from Dark Souls 1, Logan's ultimate catalyst after he had achieved enlightenment and stripped bare. Here we've got, looks like, one final study before we kind of step out of the archives proper and are able to cross over once more to Lothric Castle. And here we have overwhelming waves of nostalgia with the similarities to Boletaria. But before we get on that train, we are going to unlock a shortcut and then head back to the Firelink Shrine. Huh. Sorry. Distracted. And you'll see soon, or why soon enough, why we're heading back here. Besides just powering up our Estus flask once again. I think this is the final Estus infusion. I think plus 10 is as far as that goes. Yeah. Yeah, it's plus 10. I think the number you can have goes up to 15 maximum. But now that we have triumphed over the three guardians, who bear no similarities whatsoever to the three guardian roundtable knights in Volataria, or at least their phantoms that you dispose of in Demon Souls, we are able to acquire their gear. We already had access to what Krimhild was wearing. She actually had the Firekeeper set on, which I don't even want to open that can of worms. Who knows if that's intentional or it just looked good on her. We also have the Faram helm and set overall. Helm named after a god of war. The armor of the Ferosa Lion Knights was preserved even after the destruction of their homeland, and is mentioned in numerous legends alongside the names of those who are said to have gone beyond death. This was the iconic armor from A Dark Souls 2, and it's pretty cool looking armor. I'm not going to take that away from it. If I have any complaint, it's that the helmet, the visor is opaque. You can't see your face within it. That's a lost opportunity. And also the description is slightly irritating because go beyond death was such a cheesy catchphrase or line. Then again, prepare to die wasn't a whole lot better, so eh. We also gain access to the Black Hand hat and the Black Hand armor. As you can see, they're actually very clearly variations on the assassin set. Just a little bit longer with a cape, and throw a hat on top of that hood. But let's read them. Black Hand hat. Attire of hunters known as the King's Black Hands. This wide-brimmed hat is emblematic of the role. Black Hand was a title established to honor hunters who served successive kings. To date, no more than three such individuals have borne this distinction. And the description for the armor is, again, not too much different.
Ashen One.
We actually want to... I think we're going to want to use the Black Hand hat to round out this particular fashion. Lost opportunity. I don't know. I don't know if that's actually... I don't know if that's actually any better than the Sage's hat, but we'll roll with it. We had to take some hits to get it, so whatever. Let's head right back, because I don't think there's anything else to do in the interim. Alrighty. So we may have reached the point where we can... We may have reached the point where we can put the Grand Archives behind us, but there is still a matter of that cage on top of the archives, or I guess very near the ceiling, which we know from the Winged Knight set and the Crystal Catalyst or whatever, Crystal Chime, we know that the Heavenly Daughter Gertrude was imprisoned at the top of the archives, so we are going to want to investigate that before we move on. Quite the set piece, this area. And it doesn't need any, you know, ridiculous soundtrack or loads of action going on to make it a set piece. It just has to look good. You just have to design a good area. That's all it takes. So, what do we have up here? It would appear, scoot back a bit farther, it would appear that we have quite a trial awaiting us. The Winged Knights of this particular area don't mess around. They have true wings. The first time I came to this area, I did not notice them up there, so I had a very Joseph Joestar moment when they dropped down from above at some point in their own time. Dang, man. That dark sign. It looks like... either something is pouring forth from the dark sign, or being absorbed into it, or that's just some sort of well-known phenomena of light. Like an eclipse, I think, can sometimes do something like that. Anyway, it looks damn cool. Come on, guys. Come on down. I don't want to do this either. And then retreat. We desperately do not want to fight more than one of these guys at a time. Because they will... They will mess us up pretty handily. May as well fight the hardest one first, in my opinion. I have a much harder time... Did they ever come down? I have a much harder time with the Twin Axe enemies, or Winged Knights, than I do with the Halberd ones. Especially when they use their spin attack. Oh! Spin attack! On command. You can see they're very mobile. And yet tragically still vulnerable to backstabs. Ah, fair enough. You got your hit in. I said you got your hit in. Now it's time for you to go. Large Titanite. Yeah. That's a reward equivalent to the challenge. Let's antagonize this one. Bring it, my winged friend. Shame you can't get their golden weapons and armor. They heard me talking shit about Halberd Knights. I don't know if I'd wear the armor ever, but it'd be sort of amusing to have a golden... Jeez Louise. A golden, Winged Knight Halberd. Good lord, he does not stop, does he? Alright, maybe I take it back. Maybe these guys, the Halberds, are a little bit more challenging. Uh-oh. You fought well, my friend. but I've got Estus. And that's really all there is to it. Ah, this backstab. Oh, fuck. Ouch! Already our buff is gone. That's bloody useless. What's the point of a buff that doesn't last for even a single encounter? I don't get that at all. Oh well. For killing all three, we are rewarded with our third Titanite slab. Not the last we'll run into either. Scale the back end of the tower here. And obtain the Hunter Ring. Let's see. And you notice, unlike the other three, this one has a black image on it. A shadowed image. Ring engraved with the portrait of a hunter. Increases dexterity. The hunters serve Lothric on the fringes and in the shadows. For generations, rulers of Lothric have relied especially upon the Black Hand hunters to punish enemies in ways that the king's three pillars cannot. Assassins! So, like the other three rings before it, it gives you a plus 5 basically to your dexterity. At first, these rings kind of like in this room, what the fuck? Sorry. Seems like there should be something going on in there, but there's not. At first, I kind of had a low opinion of these rings. I was like, well, that's not, you know, very interesting, but once I considered their utility, I suppose, and like padding a stat so that you can spend your level up points elsewhere. Yeah, okay. That's fine. But you can see, you can drop down here and gain access to the cage of Gertrude, the heavenly daughter. Tragically, long expired here after being left to basically languish forever in this cell. That sucks. I would have really, really loved to see or to hear what Gertrude could have told us, what insight she has on the angels, and by extension, possibly Londor, or whoever else is behind the angels. Londor, Seath's legacy, I don't know, but feels like she would have had a lot of answers for us had she not expired. We'll just have to take what we can from the miracles she leaves behind, which we've seen the Wing Knights use on us more than once. Divine Pillars of Light. Miracle of Gertrude, the Heavenly Daughter. Brings down multiple pillars of light in vicinity. The Queen's Holy Maiden Gertrude was visited by an angel who revealed this tale to her. Despite losing both her sight and her voice, she was determined to record the tale. Ordinary men cannot decipher her fragmentary scrawl, nor comprehend how it became the foundation of the angelic faith in Lothric. The Heavenly Daughter and the Queen's Holy Maiden. Interesting. Like, it appears as if Gertrude probably, just by virtue of being the daughter of the Queen and quite possibly of Guinevere, or some descendant thereof, was already in a position of religious power or influence. Probably kind of in the capacity of like maybe an oracle or something along those lines. But she was visited by an angel and in the process lost her sight and lost her voice. These are both qualities that we have seen in Firekeeper's past. We know that the old women Firekeepers, I believe, and our current Firekeeper are quite blind. Irina is now blind, or has always been blind, in her pursuit of being a Firekeeper. I don't know if Anastasia was supposed to be blind, but she was certainly mute due to, in all likelihood, someone having cut out her tongue to keep her from ever speaking heresies. I wonder if that's not the same case with poor Gertrude here. And I get the impression, I don't know if it's true or not, but I kind of get the impression that when this happened to Gertrude, the queen and the king were probably already gone from Lothric. That's purely based on my belief in the fact that the queen seemed to not be a terrible person, given the Ashen Estus ring and the blessings divine and hidden. But on the flip side, if the angels really are agents of darkness, you know, abyssal creatures, then probably even the queen would have to do something about her wayward daughter. Either way, it was not completely effective because Gertrude's angelic message did manage to spread and did become the foundation of a faith in Lothric. Has its own knights, and I believe has many adherents that we see on the High Wall. I think a lot of those worshipping undead were those who worshipped the angels, given their typically being gathered around the trees, which resemble half-formed angels. Oh well. We make do with what we got. Down here, we've got a man grub seemingly staked out very near to Gertrude's cell. Let's not mess around with this thing too much though, because I don't want to fall and then die. I really don't. So, interesting, right? Not only does old Pontiff seem to have his fingers everywhere, seems like Rosaria has some reach as well. We've seen a man grub here in the Grand Archives, seemingly interested in Gertrude's cell. We also saw the corpse of one in Irithyll. I don't know, at this moment I don't really know exactly, or rather, I don't really have any idea as to why or how the man grub is present here, but I don't know, I guess it's something I will try to think about. Divine blessing. Twinkling Titanite. No surprise to find a divine blessing so close to the heavenly daughter. And then I believe, yep, we emerge relatively close to where we need to be. Just have to get through this nonsense to get there. I got waxed. I bet you we can make it. Yeah, they don't even reach us here. Good deal. Alright. That explored. That handled. It's time to push a little farther forward. And I didn't mention it before, but here we have yet another statue, like the one we saw at the entrance to the Grand Archives. Here we get a much better view of it. Although, trying to get a view of the face up close does not seem to want to agree with me. Yeah, the moment we try. Well, it's in the light. I'm sure our binoculars will... Okay. Treat us to that big wad of nothing. So I wonder if this is supposed to be... wax? Because wax is obviously very important here. Oh, reminds me, I have to farm up some scholar gear for the next episode. But it also, again, has that impression of having been slightly melted, like we see in the kiln, the first flame. I don't think it's the direction it's facing is of any significance. Unless it's intended to be facing Gertrude. I don't know. That's, That's something we'll just end up spinning our wheels on if we think about it for too long. So instead, let's move on to Ballataria 1-3. If you think I'm joking, check out this shit. All the old demon souls, I don't know, defensive walls. We've got three spear guys and a red-eyes knight. And the only thing they've changed really about the setup, which by the way, on a big staircase leading up to a boss fight, just like in Ballataria versus the, as you're about to reach the penetrator. The only difference here is that instead of red-eyes spear knights, we have regular Lothric guys, but at the top, we have one blue Lothric Knight and two blue Spear Knights, so that's going to be a bunch of shit if we decide to actually deal with it. I have not fully decided if we shall. Owie, owie, owie. Point of order. Aha! Let's not get killed by goddamn grunt soldiers. But, point of order, these guys have much nicer armor than the deserter armor. Ah, shit. They're already on the move, are they? Their capes have a nice blue design. I think it seems to be it's a bit more intact. We've got armor pieces on it. I wonder if we can get this armor, because I would like to have it. I rather like the deserter / Lothric Knight set that we were working with in the beginning of the game, so I wouldn't mind having a new version, more complete version of that. Ow. Listen, if you don't want to get backstabbed, then you're just going to get stunlocked. Perhaps I shouldn't talk so soon. No, really. Die. still just dropping large titanite. That drives me crazy. None of these knights should drop anything less than titanite chunks. Surprise, I do remember how to kick. Down to one Estus flask to deal with all of this. That reminds me. I really do need to see about using my... Whoa, hello. Using my Evelyn. Oh shit, they get deserter's trousers? Then we're not going to be able to get their armor. That blows. I haven't used my Evelyn at all, even though I love it. I still haven't tested it in battle, though. Simply because it makes us overweight. And that's all there is to it. It's a cool toy, but I don't want to get killed over it. Let's see if we can't... Yeah, aggro one of these guys. And then deal with him. No! Except my crossbow! Come on, man. He didn't like that. These are probably the worst guys in the world to try this on. Uh-oh. How far are they gonna come? Okay, now they're turning around. This guy, however. Let's not get too crazy, but... Haha, in your face! Oh shit! Oh, I drank my last Estus. This is craziness. Oops, I'd already loaded it. This is pure madness. It's also pure fun. Oh shit! He decided he didn't like us doing that shit after all. You're dead! Haha! I don't know what I've gained out of this. Very little, I suspect. Still, that's still the coolest goddamn crossbow ever. Like, yeah, I know this Evelyn is an old-timey crossbow in Dark Souls, but guess what? I never used it. And I don't think it was ever as cool as it is in this game, if I had to guess. Let's try to fight these guys more naturally. Yeah, blessed weapon. That's right, chase me. I'm your enemy. No, fucking enough with that. Bro, I need you to chase me so I don't have to fight your brother. Come on. Come on. You're so close. You're so close. You got this, man. No. You're a champion. You've got this. And now let's do this. It takes two kicks to get to the center of the Tootsie Pulp. Boy. Ooh, and we got an Estus as a reward. For our good play. Our good, dirty play. You hear that? It's time for the feast. Ah, please don't. Just because I dared. Because I dared to get just a little cocky. Man, these spells don't last shit either. Such a bummer. But hey, we did alright. We beat a bunch of big, bad, tough Lothric knights. We did it on one, technically two Estus. I'm alright with that. That situation. And ahead of us, what can only be our climactic confrontation with Prince Lothric. We can actually summon old Orbeck to help us. I think, God, we might. I don't know. As we've seen, me summoning allies is actually me engaging challenge mode sometimes. But here, you can see we activate a shortcut back to Lower Lothric Castle. And this is just before the boss fight with the Dragon Slayer armor. To give you a sense of where we are, where we're at. Shit. Mad props to Marcus, Epic Name Bro, for discovering this. I had no idea about it until he found it quite by accident. I should have known, right? They wouldn't pull the old elevator under an elevator trick only once. Not since they had so much fun with it in Bloodborne. And we get another Titanite slab. I don't mind. I'll take it. And a crank here. In case you, you screw up bad and you're... You, just so you won't be stuck down here. But I think that will do us for this episode. Next time, we are going to make good on that promise to hand Lothric's ass to him. Surely, with no error, no deaths, no embarrassment. It'll all go swimmingly. So I hope you will join me for that as we get very... very close indeed to the end of this wonderful game. Alright, everyone. Take it easy.